everybody, and I especially want to welcome our special guest, Congressman John Sarbanes, who's come to talk to us about campaign finance reform all the way from Maryland. I've been showing him the first congressional district for the last day or two, and just like everybody who comes here, he's very jealous that I have the best congressional district in the as so many of you know, I was just talking to some of the press outlets about campaign finance reform, and what I said is the shock and awe of the 2016 election has already started, but it only goes downhill from here in terms of the ads and the messages and so on and so forth. And of course, the cost of political campaigns has really, really skyrocketed, not just the cost of the presidential campaign, but also the cost of congressional campaigns. The Supreme Court's Citizens United decision, which of course said that corporations could have the same rights as individuals, only accelerated those costs and let people put money towards campaigning. And this is a really important event because it helps to shape the way our political discourse happens in this country. And that's why I've asked my friend and colleague John Sarbanes to come and talk to me about this very important issue of campaign finance. And it's also why I'm so happy we have our other wonderful panelists here today. We're going to talk about a wonderful bill that Congressman Sarbanes is championing, which is why he's traveling the country to talk about this. And I'm an original co-sponsor of this legislation. What it would do is it would basically institute public funding for congressional elections, which we think could really help bring politics back to the grassroots where it really needs to be. But there's a couple of other pieces of legislation I'd like to talk about. One of them is sponsored by another Maryland. You guys seem to be a hotbed of political finance reform in Maryland. Another Maryland Congressman, Chris Van Hollen, called the Disclose Act. And what this bill does, you see these ads and they say, Dianna DeGette is terrible, and she call Dianna and tell her to stop being the worst congresswoman ever, paid for by Americans for Truth and Justice, right? But who is Americans for Truth and Justice? So Congressman Van Hollen's bill, which I'm also co-sponsoring, increases the transparency of elections by requiring disclosure of any campaign donations made to these outside groups, and it also requires that the outside groups approve the content of their ads and disclose the names of major financial contributors. I think that in these cases, sunshine is the best disinfectant, and I think that that would go a long way too. Also, I think that there's a real opportunity to reshape some of the recent case law around funding elections, with the Supreme Court vacancy that we've seen caused by the death of Justice Scalia. And I really think, as somebody who used to practice quite a bit of constitutional law myself, that the Citizens United case was a very poorly conceived case. Certainly the founders did not intend that corporations be seen under the First Amendment as people. And so I think there's a real opportunity now, with this seat being filled, to make sure that we have a justice who will help review Citizens United. So that's a couple of the thoughts that I have. What I'd like to do, though, now, since he's traveled all the way from the East Coast here to talk to us about campaign finance reform, I'd really like to turn this over to my friend and my colleague, Representative Sarbanes, who's really a hero on the issue of campaign finance reform. John?
Good morning, everybody. I want to thank Dianna for closely together in Congress, and there's a wonderful package of reforms that have been put together, among them public financing, the Disclose Act, which promotes transparency in terms of where the big money is coming from, voter empowerment, protecting access to the ballot box, and other measures that are about making sure that everyday Americans feel that they have a stake in their democracy. And increasingly these days, as you know, and as I'm sure you feel oftentimes, people feel powerless when they look at Washington, when they look at politics, when they look at government. So the question is, what do we do about it? We could probably stipulate at this point across the political spectrum that money in politics is a problem, that there's too much influence by big moneyed interests, whether it's in Washington or it's in state capitals across the country, and that the average person feels kind of left out of the equation. The question, the challenge for us is, what do we do about it? What are the solutions that we want to pursue? And I wanted to speak to that just briefly, and then we're looking forward to having a good interactive conversation here. So the solutions, I think, kind of fall into two broad categories. There's a set of solutions that have to do with trying to curb the influence or rein in the conduct of the big money crowd out there. So that's where we have disclosure and transparency as a remedy. So we know these super PACs and outside groups and so-called hidden money groups are spending a lot of money, but oftentimes we don't know where that comes from. So disclosure, and you're seeing efforts at the national level to promote this, but you're also seeing it at state and local levels, is designed to at least create some accountability and transparency. So when that big money comes in, you know where it's coming from, and you can make a judgment, right? There's some accountability there, and you can decide based on who's putting the money in, what you think about the message that they're delivering. So that's one example of trying to police the conduct of the big money players. There's these things called non-coordination rules, where super PACs are not supposed to coordinate with a specific candidate, and trying to make sure that those are robust so that these relationships between candidates and these super PACs that are backing them is not just a kind of wink and nod affair, but you actually kind of keep them separate. And then, of course, there's the effort around a constitutional amendment to try to address the consequences of the Citizens United case, which really unleashed these super PACs on the kind of American political landscape. And the idea there is, let's get the power in Congress to be able to regulate the big money and put some kind of limits on the big money. So that's one set of reforms that's very important. And Dianna and I and others, many of our colleagues, support sort of a whole suite of reforms that fall into that category of kind of blowing the whistle on the big money crowd. The other approach, which I think is equally important, and this is where I've kind of put the eggs, you know, in the basket in terms of what I've pushed on Capitol Hill, is this idea that it can't just be about policing the conduct of the big money people. It's got to also be about empowering everyday citizens so that they feel like they have a stake and ownership in their own democracy again. What can we do to make it so that the person out there who's just trying to make ends meet, they want to be politically engaged, they want to feel like their democracy is responding to their voice, that they can kind of step into the arena and be a power player? And that's where I think this idea of small donor-driven public financing really has tremendous, almost transformational potential in terms of making people feel again like they have a stake in their democracy. We're seeing this playing out now at the local level and state level. We can talk more about that as the conversation goes today. People are kind of grabbing hold of this solution that says, I have power in my democracy. But let me tell you what the Government by the People Act would do, which is the proposal that we've introduced in Congress that Dianna is a co-sponsor of and a number of the other members of the delegation here, Jared Polis and Ed Perlmutter are also supporting. In fact, we have 160 co-sponsors of this bill across the country. It is bipartisan in its support because we have one Republican. God bless him. And 159 Democrats. But we're making progress there. So what would the Government by the People Act do? It's pretty straightforward. The first thing it would do is it would provide a refundable tax credit for small donations to congressional campaigns, up to $25 in each of the 2 years of an election cycle. So if you made a $50 donation to a candidate, you get $25 of that back in the form of a tax credit. The reason we did this is if we're going to build a system that's driven by small donations and everyday people out there, we got to make it easier for the average person to kind of step up into the game. And for many Americans, even a $25 political contribution is a heavy lift when you have a lot of other expenses that you need to handle. So we wanted to assist people basically in stepping into the arena with that $25 refundable tax credit. We call it the My Voice tax credit because it gives people a voice again. And think of it this way. If we live in a world now where our esteemed Supreme Court has said that money is speech, then it begs the question, how do people of modest means have speech? And one way to do that is to offer them this refundable tax credit. So that's the first piece, pretty straightforward. People step up into the funding arena using their tax credit. The second piece, and this is sort of the clincher, this is the critical piece, is if that donation goes to a candidate who agrees to meet certain requirements, and we can talk more about what those are, but basically requirements that show that they're trying to reach out to the broad public and move away from dependency on PACs and big money donors. Then the small donation that goes to that candidate will receive a 6-to-1 match of public funds. So the reason this is so important is it takes that $50 donor and makes them worth $350 to the candidate. And two things happen. One, a candidate who yesterday, before you had this legislation in place, would only be able to raise the money they need to be competitive by going to deep-pocketed donors, can now actually be viable and competitive by going to small donors and collecting those small donations and earning matching funds at a level that allows them to go out and run a viable campaign. So that's the first thing. But the most important thing about it is now that small donor, that $50 donor, has power. They can get the attention of the candidate because they're worth more than just $50. If they can assemble 30 people in their living room and have a house party and collect a bunch of small contributions that are then going to be matched on a multiple basis, all of a sudden the candidate wants to come stand in that living room and listen to the priorities and concerns of the people that are in that room, instead of going up to K Street or going to some, you know, fancy deep-pocketed fundraising event. That is an example of transformational power. And so the paradigm of the Government by the People Act is to give everyday citizens power again in their democracy so they can get the attention of the candidate, so they can compete against the big money, and they can begin to feel like they own their own democracy again. So those are the two main pieces. The third, and we can talk about this, is if a super PAC or some outside group comes in the home stretch and tries to obliterate that candidate, that grassroots candidate, there's some additional public funds that can be available. But altogether, it's about lifting up the voices of everyday citizens, lifting up candidates who in turn want to reach out and build that kind of support for their campaign, and overall taking ownership of our democracy back for we the people. And that's why we called it the Government by the People Act. Thank you.
Now what I'd like to do is I know we're ways through already, but I'd like to introduce our moderator, Elena Nunez. She has worked so tirelessly on this issue. We're not shunning her by making her sit over there. We're giving her extra power to control the operation. She's the executive director of Colorado Common Cause, and thank you so much for doing this. Elena, you're going to introduce our other two panelists and take it from there, right?
Yes.
Great, thanks.
Thank you, Congresswoman DeGette, and thank you, Congressman Sarbanes, for being here. I think this is such an incredible opportunity. Can you all hear me in the back?
No.
All right, how about now? All right, let's move it a little closer. Is that better?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much for having this conversation. I think it's appropriate here in Colorado because we, as much as anyone, see the impacts of money on our political process. Every year that there's a general election, we are the target of this special interest money. We see it in our mailboxes, we see it on our television screens. In fact, in 2014, there was more than $100 million spent just on broadcast television ads. And if you watch them all back to back, it would take you 43 days. I don't know that that's what any of us imagine when we talk about government of, by, or for the people, so it's really exciting to have this conversation and be able to dig in to the real solutions that we have to empower all of us to have a greater voice and also to take back our democracy. So I'm excited to be here and excited to welcome our panelists. I'd first like to introduce Kirsten Forsett. She's the political and legislative director of the AFL-CIO. Most recently, she was the chief of staff for Colorado Senate President during the 2013 and 2014 legislative sessions and for the Senate Minority Leader in 2015. Prior to becoming the chief of staff, she directed numerous candidate and issue campaigns with a high success rate, and she was the executive director at Progress Now Colorado and state director for Colorado for Healthcare, which was a project of the SEIU. And then she also holds a bachelor's and master's degree from the University of Montana in political science. Our other panelist, Kim Stevens, is the State Director for Environment Colorado, coordinating all of Environment Colorado's campaign work to protect Colorado's air, water, and open spaces. And Kim draws on 7 years of experience grassroots organizing and advocating for policies to protect our environment. Prior to working with Environment Colorado, Kim was an organizer with COPERG, the Colorado Public Interest Research Group, organizing hundreds of students to take action to reduce the impacts of global warming through energy efficiency. And I think we're really lucky to have both of them here today to talk about how money and politics affects the issues we all care about. So to start us off, let's start big picture. And I think many of us have opinions on this, but I'd love to hear what our panelists think. What are some of the biggest problems with the current campaign finance laws and rules? So let's start big, and then we can dig in a little more. Kirsten, why don't we start with you?
Okay, can you hear me? Okay. So I would say...
Just put the mic right up to you.
Right up to my face. Okay. I would say one of the biggest obstacles that I see in campaign finance, one of the most frustrating things, I have been on both sides. I have worked on what they consider the dark money side, and I have worked with candidates directly. I prefer the candidates directly, truthfully. It is much more fun, and it's so inspirational to be with these impressive candidates who just truly care about their district, want to go door-to-door, want to have town halls, want to go to every single community event, naturalization ceremonies, whatever it may be, and just getting out in their community. It's very exciting to work with new candidates in particular. Part of the problem that I see that is most frustrating out of it is the requirement right now for a House district candidate who is running in a competitive race is between 8 and 10 hours a day on the phone, just doing fundraising calls. That's all they do. And so there's this kind of fight that ends up happening between a candidate who really cares and wants to get out and talk to their constituency and get to know their people and be part of their community. Instead, they're having to spend 8 to 10 hours a day sitting in a room on a phone. And so it's not only that it's they're not reaching their constituency and they're not actually doing what I think they truthfully wanted to do, but it's a true injustice to that legislative district. I mean, it's very frustrating to watch. And so forcing them to be stuck there is prohibiting any sort of grassroots mobilization. And I don't see any point in the campaign where it lets up. There's no point where all of a sudden you hit July, you know, of 2016, and oh, okay, you can stop dialing for dollars. It's just not the case. You have to sit there and dial for dollars and hope that the television commercials and that the mail pieces and that everything else that is being sent out by either the outside groups or even your own campaign is enough to convince people that you are a good candidate. Which is really unfortunate because having interactions like this with your congressionals is really wonderful because you get to know them well, you get to understand the issues, and it's really exciting, I'm sure, for them as well to be able to reach out in their communities. So I would say that to me is one of the biggest, and I think Elena pointed out very clearly how much money is being spent. There is projected to be about $4.4 billion just on television commercials for the presidential campaign this this year. So, you know, it keeps growing exponentially every single year. Once we think, like, it can't get any worse, it does. And so that's where we are. So I think looking at the broader perspective, it is hard on the public and it's hard on the candidate and actually prevents them from being part of their community and actually understanding what matters.
Thanks, Kim.
Yes. Hi, everyone. I'm very loud, so I hope you can all hear me, but let me know if you can't. So yes, I am the state director with Environment Colorado, and I have the fun opportunity to talk to you all about how the issues that I work on every day and are very near and dear to my heart are being the progress to actually protect the environment and tackle big issues facing our environment like climate change are being blocked because of big money in politics. And climate change especially, I mean, this is a huge issue facing our world, but here in Colorado in particular, out doing my work every day, talking with average citizens, people are feeling the impacts of a changing climate. So whether I am up in northern Colorado talking to a farmer who has to change when they're planting their tomatoes because of unprecedented precipitation, or the owner of a ski company out in Summit County who is worried about the future of their industry, people are feeling the impacts. And everyone I talk to has a story to share of how they're impacted in their own personal way. And you would think that that would be enough to make sure that our decision makers are acting on climate. But big money in politics is definitely blocking progress at a lot of different levels. The good news is that we have seen huge progress. So before I dive in, who here has heard of the Clean Power Plan? Okay, it's like half the room. So the Clean Power Plan, it's a historic rule that will set the first ever limits on global warming pollution from coal-fired power plants. So that's a big deal because this pollution accounts for half or about 40% of our total emissions that are contributing to global warming. So historic rule, the EPA and President Obama finalized that this fall, and now our states are working to come up with plans to actually make sure that we cut this pollution and avoid the worst impacts of climate change. So unfortunately though, despite this amazing progress, polluters are working at every single level to try to keep this rule from going into effect. And it's really not a surprise if you look at where money is coming from and funding elections of candidates in Washington, D.C. So there's this really wonderful website, it's called opensecrets.com, and it makes it pretty clear where candidates are getting their money from. So opensecrets.com shows that in 2014, in the election cycle, the energy industry, which is led by the Koch brothers and the Koch industry, gave over $115 million to candidates' campaigns. And now, in this election cycle, we are already over $100 million, and this is only the tip of the iceberg. So money from the energy industry is flowing in. And so it's no surprise that Republicans in Washington, D.C. are prioritizing blocking the Clean Power Plan as their number one priority, because about 80% of this money from the energy industry is going to Republican candidates. So this is a huge problem. We need to be acting on climate change right now and enacting every solution that we can to avoid the worst impacts of climate change. And definitely this big money in politics is making it hard for our candidates to actually move forward with the solutions that we have at our fingertips.
I just want to add to that last statement. Both Congressman Sarbanes and I sit on the Energy and Commerce Committee in the U.S. House of Representatives, and I think we'll agree on this. It is really frustrating to us when we sit in these committee hearings, and we actually did pass a climate change bill through the House when Nancy Pelosi was the Speaker. I was the vice chairman of the Energy and Commerce Committee, and we passed it through the House by a very narrow margin, but then we weren't able to bring it up in the Senate never took it up. And it is frustrating when we sit there in these hearings and we listen to our colleagues talking about and we've had many votes, we had some votes this year already, about where we're trying to say climate change is an urgent problem, and we need to work together in a bipartisan way to solve it. But then it's the votes that you have in committee are straight along straight party lines, and where you actually have people, members of Congress, denying that climate change exists. I think that the U.S. House of Representatives is probably the only place where people still work at a high level where they don't think climate change exists. But privately, many of them will tell you that they recognize climate change exists and that it's an urgent problem. But they will tell even people like us privately that they feel that their hands are tied and they can't do anything to find solutions.
I just had a couple of comments based on what was said a moment ago. First of all, Kirsten's point about let me start on the environmental issue. There was a report that was issued by Oil Change International, the Sierra Club. We were just talking about that before the panel started, that showed that the oil and gas industry is earning a 5,800% return on the investment it's making in campaigns. In other words, they're spending millions of dollars, as was just indicated, in contributing to political campaigns, but they're earning billions of dollars of return on that in the form of ongoing taxpayer subsidies on an annual basis and so forth. So it's an investment well worth making. And it gets us to this question of why public financing is such a powerful solution, because what it represents is the American people stepping up and investing in their democracy so that they can earn the return. If it was small donors and public matching funds that were underwriting campaigns in this country, then when it came time to make policy, the return on that investment would flow to the American people and to the public. But as long as the investment in those campaigns is coming from these large industries that have particular interests and agendas, the public policy is going to end up flowing in their direction. So that's the first point. The second point is this idea that Kirsten was talking about, that you have members of Congress and other candidates who are spending, 7 to 10 hours a day as the campaign intensifies because they have to raise the money that it takes to run a competitive election. Well, that's because there's only one place to go right now to get the money. It's from the deep-pocketed donors that you're going to get on the phone when you make those calls. But if you created a system that rewarded a candidate for finding the small donor, then instead of being holed up in some room on the telephone, it would be in their interest to go have a house party, right? And invite 30 people, have them each make a $50 donation, earn a 6-to-1 match of public funds on that, and be able to raise $10,000. So to raise money for your campaign and power your campaign, your incentive is not to go sit in a room somewhere and call high donors. Your incentive is actually to go have a house party with real constituents in your district. So as the campaign intensifies, the incentive for you to get out and be with the people also intensifies at the same time. That's the beauty of that kind of solution, because it lines the incentives up in a way that makes the candidate reach out and touch the electorate.
And I'm going to guarantee you there is not a person who runs for Congress or any other office who says, what I'm really looking forward to is sitting in a room for 7 to 10 hours, calling people who aren't going to talk to me and asking for money. People would much rather be at it. And I think that probably goes across party lines. I think Democrats and Republicans would much rather be out talking to their constituents.
The parties are more fun.
Yeah, the constituents are more fun.
And I think that's such a great point, because it really highlights how small donor empowerment systems are good both for donors, so we as people having a greater voice, but then it also will impact public policy. So in my home state of Arizona, which had a public financing system, Governor Janet Napolitano, when she ran for governor the first time, she ran using Arizona's public financing model, which is a bit different than what's being proposed, but a similar system in that you needed to show support from small donors. And I remember my parents telling me about it, because they were really excited that they had made $5 contributions to help her run for office. And in the public financing scheme, a $5 contribution under Arizona's law was the empowering contribution to allow someone to run for office. So a small check meant that they were contributing in a way that was meaningful. I think most of us, if we were to write a $5 check right now to a candidate, would feel like that really wasn't going to go too far in helping them run for office. So that's important, but I think the flip side is that when Governor Napolitano took office, one of her first acts was to sign a prescription drug reform bill. And at the bill signing, what she said was that she was able to do that because she was representing the people of Arizona, and that's what they wanted, and not what the pharmaceutical industry, who traditionally fund a lot of campaigns, what they would want. So I think we would see a real impact in terms of public policy. And I think the other lesson, and I'd like to dig into this a little bit with our panel, is that we know that this isn't an issue that, when it comes to popular support, divides along party lines. And I think Colorado is a good example, where using the ballot box, we've time and again adopted campaign finance reform, ethics reform, the call for a constitutional amendment, and we've seen support in overwhelming numbers from both Democrats and Republicans. Most recently, the Amendment 65 ballot measure, every county in the state, even those that were most red, passed the call for the constitutional amendment. So we all agree there's a problem, yet we're not seeing the movement we need to. So the question for the panel that I think we should spend some time on is, what are the strategies that we should be looking at that are important to build the support? Because we know that the public all agrees that there's a problem, and we know that there are real solutions. So what do we need to do to build support to make that happen?
So this is kind of a loaded question. So I think there's two things that need to happen. Obviously, what we're talking about here today is on the candidate side. On the dark money side, that is something that was decided by the Supreme Court and is going to take a longer fight that we have to figure out. So dealing with what we actually can control, I think, is part of the conversation here today. But I don't want to pretend like this whole other dark money piece doesn't exist, because it's out there and it's really awful and it's really reprehensible to watch. I've worked at the Capitol now for 4 years, and Americans for Prosperity is getting stronger and stronger and stronger there. And there was recently even a fight between one of the senators and Americans for Prosperity over Twitter, where he's basically saying, I'm not going to be controlled by billionaires anymore. And they came right back at him, and he's afraid of being primary just by that organization. So, I mean, the dark money side of it is vital, and I think that, you know, needs to be one of our big priorities. But working within where we can be, one, I agree that we should have disclosure. I think one of the things to keep in mind with unions that is different and that is very unique is that unions essentially operate as a small donor committee. We have what are called COPE committees that people donate into, and then those COPE committees turn around, endorse their candidates, and hand over that money to whatever candidate that they endorsed. So the current system within unions, both federally and statewide, are in the state of Colorado, operate in a way that is trying to empower little voices, you know, small donor individuals that exist within workplaces right now. People can opt into this. This is not required by any means as part of their union membership. It's just something that they're giving additional. And so this is our way of kind of creating collective power. I think this is one place where you can really see where collective power works and why something like this model would actually help. Because you can see within unions, the larger the voices, or the more voices that you have, the larger the voice becomes. And so I think if the more we could move towards that small donor model, the more collective power we actually have, stronger voice we have moving forward. So the one thing to keep in mind moving forward with some of these requirements is making sure that we are not in any way impacting what collective voices exist right now. I mean, I think the union itself supports reasonable disclosures, but in terms of there are some campaign finance reform that has been introduced that just specifically targets unions itself, trying to get at the small donors and disclosing only those individuals who are contributing, you know, $25 to $50. So I think we just have to be weary of what actually the legislation does. So one, I totally agree that we need to support the Disclosure Act. I think the way it was introduced in the House is where we are most supportive. There are some Senate amendments that have caused AFL in particular to not support where the current version is. For HR 20, absolutely, I think this is the way to go. And I think Colorado has been a great model for how we can run this on the candidate side in particular and how it's been effective. Every state legislative race and House district race, they go door to door. Every single one of them get out and walk door to door. And to actually be able to see that on the congressional level would be incredible, because people have the time to spend, you know, 8 hours a day going door to door rather than spending that 8 hours raising money. So I think it's a wonderful step forward, getting this dialogue going, and trying to figure out how we can get it through Congress, I think is going to be one of our biggest obstacles. But I will say that having the collective force and power behind the unions, and then the collaborative partners we have here in Colorado, are really impressive. We work really well with Montpert, with Environment Colorado, with Conservation Colorado, with Common Cause, in order to advance campaign finance reforms that work to empower voices within Colorado. So I think, you know, definitely coming away from this, I will work more with membership to help them understand why this is important and how they need to be pushing. And as much as possible, we will try and meet with our congressionals, have our members come in, and try and get them to support as well.
So before we move on, I'm wondering, Congressman Sarbanes, if you would talk a little bit about the People PAC provisions that are in the Government by the People Act, because I think that is an innovative model to really empower small donors to have the ability to come together and have a greater voice.
So it kind of follows on what Kirsten was saying, and that is one of the requirements in order to qualify for the public financing under H.R. 20, the Governed by the People Act, is that candidates have to agree to give up traditional PAC money, because there's very heavy dependence on the PAC world right now in Congress. But we did want to make sure that we preserve the opportunity for some kind of an intermediary to be able to collect small donations. So we created something called a People PAC. That's the concept. And those are PACs that in turn raise their funds from small donors. So the concept is either directly a small donor's donation to a candidate, or indirectly a small donor's donation to a People's PAC that's then in a position to help the candidate. The funding for that candidate is coming essentially from the grassroots. And it's all, again, about making sure that the voices of everyday people out there who otherwise would not be heard have some kind of power in the system. So it's an important feature, again, to protect the power of the individual citizen.
Thank you. I just want to follow up on this whole issue about disclosure and talk a minute more about that, because I think Kirsten raises an excellent point about small donors. But I think if you donate to my campaign, if you donate $50, then I, you know, I have to disclose that, and I do disclose that. And I think most labor union members would be happy to have their donations disclosed. They just don't want to be singled out where a large corporation that is doing independent expenditures doesn't have to disclose anything. But then you're targeting these small donors. But let me tell you why I think disclosure is really an integral part of everything that we do. Number one, there's been some research that has shown that when you actually require large donors who are donating, who are either making independent expenditures, who are donating through 527s or through other mechanisms, right now they can be shielded from their names being put out there. But research has shown that when you require disclosure of their names, and when you require disclosure of the names of the people who are setting up these organizations, then people think twice before paying hundreds of thousands of dollars or millions of dollars from their pockets, because the spotlight of the press and everything else will be on them. So it actually has an effect of reining in some of the more excessive actions of these shadowy organizations. But the second thing I've always advocated, and this is actually an idea that in the past has been propounded by Republicans, is with the advent of electronic reporting, I think that now it would be relatively easy for campaigns, for a requirement that when a campaign received a donation over a certain amount, say $1,000 or something like that, then you would have to report that within a certain period of time, 24 or 48 hours. We have to do that right now during the last days of the campaign, but during the rest of the campaign, we don't. Why would this make a difference? Well, Congressman Sarbanes and I both know people who will have large fundraisers with PACs and lobbyists 2 or 3 days before a major vote on an issue. We've seen it happen many times. And if you had mandatory reporting within a certain period of time of donations, then good government organizations like Common Cause could take that information, put two and two together, and let the citizens know what their representatives were up to. And I think that also would have an effect of kind of cleaning up some of these very distasteful practices that we've seen with our own eyes.
Right. I think that is a significant piece. We've had major strides in technology, but you wouldn't guess if you tried to look up campaign finance reports either at the state or federal level. And you shouldn't have to have a team of researchers to tell you who's funding a campaign, where the money is coming from, but that's still unfortunately the case. So I think there's a lot we can do to both provide that transparency, so as Congressman DeGette says, we can make that connection, but then I think that also maybe will help us build support to say there's really a problem here, we need to change the way we fund campaigns.
It might even change the way elected officials act.
Exactly.
Which was the goal.
Exactly. So Kim, I want to get back to you and talking about how we can build strategies for support, because I think you've been doing some great work to connect an issue to the broader campaign finance landscape.
Yeah, thanks, Elena. This is the fun part. This is when I ask everyone here to take some sort of action today, so get ready for that. Our organization, Environment Colorado, we're all about the grassroots. So we're all about people like you getting up and taking action, telling your decision makers what you want to see to make our democracy work better, protect our environment, and protect the issues that you care about. And the good news is that there is hope. I feel like a lot of times when I'm talking with our members and they're concerned about climate change or these other big issues facing our environment, they see special interest money as this insurmountable obstacle that we just are not going to be able to get around. And I feel like that sometimes too. I'm sure folks here in the room feel like that at different points as well. But the good news is that we're in a really interesting place, especially here in Colorado. We had this issue come to the ballot, and 74% of Coloradans, whether the Republican or Democrat, voted for a constitutional amendment to get big money out of politics. That is huge. We have a lot of support. We know the public is with us. So now it's all about making sure that we're educating folks about the solutions and then actually implementing these small donor empowerment programs, not only at the national level, which is incredibly important, but then at the local level. So citizens like us can see change and can actually see, wow, my dollar can actually make a difference on this election, and it's not going to be overpowered by these special interests. So here is what you can do right now. There are organizations in the room that are working on this issue day in and day out, and they need your help. So Common Cause, COPERG, we have Jesse and Danny Katz here in the front, if you guys want to give a little wave. And they are working to get these small donor empowerment programs not only passed at the federal level, but then also here in Colorado at the local municipal level. And they need folks like you to be weighing in with our city councilors and telling them that you want to have a say in our democracy and you actually want your vote to count, because that's how democracy is supposed to work. So be sure before you leave today to stop by and talk to either Elena or the folks at COPERG. They have a table right outside. Sign up. Jesse, do you have a petition? Great. There's a petition. Can make a difference right now today. So that we can actually get big money out of politics and reinvigorate our democracy.
Excellent. And I think that's right. There's so much we can do locally to demonstrate both that there's an appetite for reform and also that reform is possible. And I think it's a mistake to focus solely on one strategy, whether it's the constitutional amendment, whether it's small donor empowerment, whether it's local disclosure or anything like that. We have to push all of them and show that this is something we want. And there's the municipal work that's going on, which is really exciting. There's some disclosure work that Common Cause and the AFL-CIO and other partners have been working on at the state level around school board elections. And I think there's a lot we can do to just really show that there's a drumbeat of enthusiasm and that this doesn't have to be an issue that we talk about but that there aren't solutions to. So I think that's really exciting. So we have a little bit of time to open it up for questions. There's a mic in the center of the room, so please go up, and if you have a question for the panel, please do so. There's a lot of you, which is great, so let's try to keep the questions brief so everyone has a chance to be a part of this conversation.
Hi, my name is Jennifer. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, my name is Jennifer. I'm a UCD student, non-traditional, and I've gone back to school to study political science because I'm really pissed off at Monsanto. But one of the things that concerns me a lot that I learned about last semester, I grew up in agriculture. My family are farmers, we've got cattle, et cetera, et cetera. One of the things that I found startling that I learned last semester when I was doing a presentation about beef production was the significant level of secret waste that seems to be coming from CAFOs that seems to be something that I have never heard about. Not living in Oklahoma, not living in Colorado, I never hear about this, and they're also huge campaign donors in Washington. So I know that they're inundating candidates with hush money, basically, so that they can get away, continue to get away with doing what they're doing to the environment. And I was just curious, are CAFOs being addressed in Washington for their large contributions and their environmental disastrous impact that they are currently having?
Well, I would just say there's not as much transparency with respect to that industry as there should be, and I think it would be demanded by the people if they kind of understood the amount of influence that they have. But look, that's not unusual. That's kind of par for the course.
Right.
Just about every industry that has an agenda, and for many of those industries, it is in fact hiding information, because they know that if the information were available to the public would rise up. And we sit on a committee where, frankly, we get testimony sometimes, and we can't believe the lack of transparency that exists with respect to certain kinds of industries. But as you say, their ability to thwart the kind of disclosure and information education that I think the people would benefit from comes from the fact that they're putting a lot of campaign money on the table in Washington. And let me say this, it's not like a transactional quid pro quo thing necessarily. I mean, it's not like a member of Congress gets some donation from a particular industry and they say, okay, I'm gonna vote for that industry. It's more that you develop blind spots. It's human nature, right? If you become particularly dependent on a certain source of money, then when it comes time to vote on policy that affects that source, you're going to have a blind spot. You're going to kind of lean in their direction. You may not even realize that you're doing it, but that's the way human nature is. So the answer, again, is to have the money come from a different place. And that place is where America lives. That's where the people live. And that's what small donor public financing is all about.
And just to add to that, with respect to that specific question, I'm the senior Democrat on the Oversight and Investigation Subcommittee on Energy and Commerce. So we should be doing investigations on issues like this. But this is where the donation issue comes in, because when... It's like John says, when you are, it's not like they come to you and they say, shut this down, we're not going to do an investigation. It's like when anybody complains, they say, the industry comes in and says, this really isn't a big deal. You don't need to investigate this. And then the people who are in the majority, which is right now, it's the Republicans in Congress, they say, we don't need to do an investigation on that, so it never gets on people's radar screens. And it's frustrating to people like us. The Oversight and Investigations Committee on Energy and Commerce has traditionally been a very bipartisan investigatory committee. We did the food safety investigations a few years ago. We did the Enron investigations in a totally bipartisan way. But now, you know, if we have an issue like this, then they don't even do the research to find out, is there a problem?
Yeah. And then just one quick thing to add, just on the issue of ag runoff and what it means for our environment. Environment America, Environment Colorado, we are working to tackle this issue, but yes, it's really big because the American Farm Bureau spends billions of dollars. But there are some things that we can do, and so if you want to talk to me after, I can let you know a little bit more about that.
Next question.
Thank you all so much for taking the time to join us today. Thank you both for the work that you're doing in Congress to hopefully start bringing people back into the process. And that's what I want to talk about right now, is the term that we need activists on the ground to support you guys in office so that we can change the legislation. Right now, the Tea Party runs the House, so it's great that 159 Democrats support this bill, but when the Tea Party runs the House of Representatives, the bill probably won't be going far. Right now, we have one candidate running for president who is funding his campaign through small donor contributions. Record numbers of small donor contributions. And here in the state of Colorado last week, the voters, by 60% to 40%, voted in favor of that candidate, and his name is Senator Bernie Sanders. So I think it's very apt that you guys talked about today that those candidates need an incentive to actually put down the phone for 8 hours a day and go out with the community. Bernie Sanders is showing people like you right now that you can put the phone down, that there are people like us that will take our kids to meetings like this. We'll spend the little bits of free time that we have because we're struggling just to get by. That's why we don't have a free time. But then we have processes like the superdelegates, where I remember in an HD2 meeting a couple months ago, Representative DeGette, you informed us that no matter how Colorado votes, you will be casting your vote for Secretary Clinton. Regardless of the fact that 60% of your constituents just supported the one candidate who's funding his campaign through what you're talking about here, small donor campaigns. We want to give people who are sitting on the sidelines or congresspeople or senators an incentive to put down the phone. Superdelegates, you guys have the power this summer to really do that by actually casting those votes that have the potential to negate the hard work of thousands of your constituents.
Sir, with I don't one want to vote. Cut you off. There okay. are a lot of folks in the
awesome.
Minnesota.
Awesome.
There's a question.
So if I could just ask, will you actually put your money where your mouth is and support the candidate for president who is funding it with small donor contributions when you have the chance as a superdelegate? Because it looks like the superdelegates are going to tip the scales. So you're going to stand with your constituents.
I can make that. Okay. Thank you for coming today. Let me tell you, that's not exactly what this panel's about, but I want to answer your questions,
okay.
So I will, because I think there's other people here who are interested in it. And what I will tell you is this. This is not the first time I've been down this road, because in 2008, I was the co-chair in Colorado for Hillary Clinton. And of course, Barack Obama won the caucuses here in Colorado, and then he won the delegate vote. I worked tirelessly to make sure he got elected president, and I've worked tirelessly with him ever since. So I understand this. Let me say that the reason that I endorsed Hillary Clinton early on in this election is because I've worked with her for 20 years now. And I'll just give you one example. And you know, one thing, I'm a Democrat. One thing we care about as Democrats is we care about, you know, about supporting people whose policies we believe in. And I also served with Bernie Sanders in the House. I have a lot of respect for Bernie, and I agree with most of his positions, particularly on campaign finance and other things. But with this personal relationship I've had with Hillary Clinton, for example, you remember when she was First Lady, she tried to work on healthcare reform. That was the last big time it happened. And the special interests that we're talking about here today, big pharma, big corporations, they were able to stop that effort by the White House. And so Hillary Clinton, what she did was she realized that there were millions of kids in this country who didn't have health insurance because they were just above the poverty level. So she came up with the Children's Health Insurance Program, and she came to Congress, and I was a second term member of Congress then, and I worked with her to help pass this, and you know, we were able to pass it in a bipartisan way through a Republican House and a Republican Senate, and because of that, millions of kids got health care. So that's sort of my personal reason, but I will tell you from my perspective, and you know, this is not a Democratic Party event, but I will tell you as a Democrat that I think that we will be able to come together in the next few months around this. I will guarantee you Hillary Clinton does support campaign finance reform. She supports public funding. And, you know, sir, you're laughing, but I want to tell you what, excuse me, let me finish. Excuse me. Excuse me, sir, let me.
Okay.
Let me finish, please.
That's all I need to hear.
You don't want to hear the rest of my answer?
I heard it.
Because what I'm going to say is the Republican nominee is either going to be Donald Trump or it's going to be Ted Cruz. And I think the Democrats better all come together around a candidate who will support the values and ideals that we care about. And I will look forward to working with you about that. And if you want to talk some more afterwards, after everybody else gets to ask their questions, I am happy to do it because I think it's really an important discussion.
Let me just make a point that goes to just the policy around trying to lift up small donors, because I think it's important to understand this. Senator Sanders has certainly demonstrated the power of the small donor to lift up a presidential campaign. And a lot of that has to do with his ability to kind of tap into a viral energy across the country. And that can't be denied. I mean, that's incredibly impressive, and he's been able to power his campaign that way. One of the problems we have for Congress, though, is the typical rank-and-file member of Congress, it's very hard for them to get that kind of viral energy going that starts to bring in a whole ton of small donations overnight. You can do it in a marquee, sort of nationalized race. You can do it if you light your hair on fire. So for example, that guy Joe Wilson who yelled, "You lie," at the president in a joint session of Congress, raised $1.6 million within 48 hours in like $30 increments because he became a folk hero to a certain group of people out there. Yeah, exactly right. But for the average member of Congress, it's harder for them to generate that kind of viral energy that can completely power their campaign from small donors. So that's why it becomes so important to create this small donor matching system, because otherwise they're incredibly vulnerable to the people that write the big checks. Because the average cost of a campaign, a winning campaign fund is right now, small donations plus public matching funds would actually allow candidates, the typical rank and file candidate, to run and win based on the power of small donors and then go to Washington and be able to push back on the influence that this big money has. So I think that's an important observation to make.
I'd also like to thank you all for coming. My name is Vince Bowen. I'd like to just preface my question by asking a question. How many people in here have college degrees? And how many people have advanced degrees? Yeah, so this to me is the issue. You talked about the ability to catch people's imagination, to light people on fire. I think the reason we don't light people on fire is that a lot of people are missing from this room. The reason that Trump is popular, the reason that the Tea Party is popular, is that working class white folks are pissed off. They've lost their wage power. They've lost their enfranchisement. They feel disenfranchised. And they've already risen up. They understand the problem. The solution, however, that's been put forth for them is not this rational solution, but the solution of fascism, racism, sexism, etc. So what I'd like to ask of you all is, how can you solve the problem without recognizing that the evil genius of the Republican Party and the right is by is redefining white folks from working class folks to one step away from being Bill Gates. And as long as we have white folks who don't understand that the enemy is corporate manipulation and corporate money, as long as we don't understand that and don't tell that story, how do we actually light people afire and get people behind this?
Well, you know, that's a really important question. And let me tell you that, you know, maybe these guys would like to chime in, and then I have a thought on that, too.
So if I could just pick up on that. Yes, it's a major problem, and I think the unions spend the vast majority of their time trying to figure this out. And you actually see it in the labor movement as well, where you see these disenfranchised middle-class white males, truthfully, who are losing hope. Part of what we've been working on here in Colorado, we did it last year, and then we're doing it again this year, is a workforce development package, which is working on trying to figure out how we are moving people not just directly into college pipelines and then saying, well, you're not college material, and so here's another alternative for you, but instead starting off with talking to people about what they really like to do, what they would like to see, and then creating apprenticeships, very similar to what the unions have done for over 100 years in terms of, you know, pipe fitters or electricians, but trying to figure out how you're fitting people into areas where they would like to be. Not everybody wants to go to college, and making it sound like it's a horrible thing that this person doesn't want to go to college and instead would rather go into an apprenticeship or a trade school is bad overall, because the vast majority of people are not going to end up with a degree. So we've been working on doing apprenticeships and pre-apprenticeships and trying to get that through. There's a large national movement around it. And truthfully, I know this is weird coming from a very strong labor person. I spend so much time in the room with some of these owners of businesses trying to figure out how we make this work and how we move people into those positions. So part of it is taking this millennial generation and making sure that they're well taken care of, but also fitting the job retraining in. So our apprenticeships currently within the union, the average age is 28 years old. And so you have a lot of older people who are coming back into the workforce, changing careers, doing whatever, want to try something different. Those people you really have to empower. And then, so that's the uplifting part of it. The saddest part of it here is trying to push up wages is one of the hardest things we have right now. So this year we are looking at supporting a minimum wage increase that would change the Colorado Constitution to increase the minimum wage to $12 an hour and start bumping it up from there. The thought here is by increasing the minimum wage, you bring up the middle class as well. Everybody else follows because, you know, if you have a good quality worker, you don't want them being paid minimum wage. So you bump everybody up. But it's a long-term systemic problem, and from a union perspective in particular, I feel like it's important to gain collective power within your workplace in order to demand higher wages. If workers are not going to demand higher wages, whether you do it through a union or not, I don't care, truthfully, but if you're not demanding it in your workplace, it's going to be extremely difficult for you to get. They would rather pocket the profits than they would give it to you. So that's just
you know, let me also add to that. The reason why voters are so disaffected this year is because we've had this economic recovery, but it hasn't gone to everybody. It, you know, sure, the unemployment rate's gone down, but people are still underemployed. People are still only partially employed, and for the people who do have jobs, many of them, their wages have been stagnant. What you're seeing right now is you're seeing the biggest dichotomy between the wealthiest and the middle class that this country has ever seen. And so there's a bunch of proposals that people like John and I support that would level that playing field more. Also, we have a federal minimum wage bill that we've both supported that we're trying to increase the minimum wage. And that's why I make the point, I mean, you're right, the people who, you know, most of my constituents who are trying to support their families, they're having to work 2-3 jobs to do that. They can't come to a forum like this. And I really want to thank you guys for coming and bringing your little girl, because it is important that we talk about this. But there's a lot that we need to deal with in Congress on income equality. And we're not going to do that as long as John and I are in the smallest minority that the Democrats have had in Congress since 1929. Because the people on the, it's not just the Tea Party, it's the Speaker of the House and the others. This is not their priority. So I agree with you. And there's one more thing, and I bet you John's gonna say this, so I'll let him say it, which is when you have a campaign finance system like the one we have right now, it only feeds into this voter disaffection.
Well, what I was gonna say is, look, people are incredibly angry. Let's stipulate to that. Everybody knows it. The question is, where are you going to take the anger? Do you want to burn the house down, or do you want to take over the house? Okay? The House of Representatives is called the people's house. So let the people decide, do they want to burn it down? And a lot of the people following Trump, I think, that's their instinct. Let's burn the thing down. Let's burn it to the ground. Well, then all you've got is ashes. That doesn't help the people in. Or you can say, let's go take over the people's house, right? And the way you do that is you go out and you start changing the system. You start whispering. Did you hear there's another system we're building to finance campaigns in this country where the people will be in charge? Let me tell you about it. Now, Maine, which is not known for its racial diversity, on November 3rd, strengthened their campaign finance system. And they have the most blue-collar legislature in America. Electricians and plumbers are running for office and winning because they collect small donations, they get public funding, and they go serve and they represent their communities. That's a place to take your anger. Diane Russell in Maine, 15 years working as a grocery store clerk at a local shopping center. Always wanted to run for the Maine legislature, couldn't raise the money to do it. They put a system where you collect small donations in there and you get public funding. She ran, she collected hundreds of small donations, she won, she served, and 4 years ago she was named by Salon Magazine as one of the most progressive legislators in America. That's taking over the house, not burning it down. And so it's about where we take the anger, what kind of solutions we want to create so that the people are back in charge. I think we can do this. I think it's undeniable we can do it. Let me tell you a story real quick, and then I'll stop. So I went to New Hampshire a couple years ago, and I marched with Lawrence Lessig. You may remember, ran for president, won this issue. And we marched in zero-degree weather in memory of Granny D. Haddock, Doris Haddock, who in the year 2000 marched from Pasadena, California, Washington, D.C., with a sign on her back to say campaign finance reform at the age of 88. She walked 3,000 miles. So every year, in her memory, they do this march across New Hampshire. So I marched with Lessig. And we had a forum that night at the University of Concord. And Lessig produced a poll that said that 96% of Americans think that money in politics is a problem. But 91% think there's nothing we can do about it. Now, Larry was obsessed with finding the 4% who don't think it's a problem. I was inspired by the fact that there were 5% who think we can do something about it. Because if there's 5%, then you can get to 10%. And you can get to 15%. And I told that story to Andy Bossi, who's the executive director of the Maine elections reform effort, when I campaigned for them up in August. And he got all excited. He said, maybe if we win here in Maine, which, by the way, they did on November 3rd, 55-45% to strengthen their system. He said, maybe if we win here in Maine, that 5% will become 10%. And maybe if we win in Seattle, which we did on November 3rd, and they put a system in place, that 10% goes to 15%. We can do this. It's just a matter of deciding that we have the will. So I think there is a solution to it.
Moderator prerogative. We are over time, but we want to give everyone a chance to ask their question. So what we're going to do is do lightning round. Everyone come up, ask your question, please. Just ask the question and refrain from context, and then we'll have the panel respond so we can close it out.
And just to follow up, I mean, I think the truth is the key. As a former Goldman Sachs banker myself, I know we're not bad guys, but you, Senator, Representative DeGette, are in Hillary's camp. Hillary has been a senator in New York There's a thing called carried interest, which allows hedge fund managers, investment bankers to have lower taxes. And she has been working on that for 40 years and not doing anything. And the reason that people are upset, like this gentleman, is that we are not telling the truth about both parties doing this sort of thing. So the righteous indignation has to be truth-telling about both parties being compromised.
All right, everyone, we're going to go quick question and then let give everyone a chance to speak.
Thank you. Steve Giustino, chair of Colorado Move to Amend. I'm going to cut my context way down, but I got to make two quick statements. The problem with legislative fixes, any legislative fix, is it can be overturned by a hostile court, including any legislation we've discussed today. The problem with a constitutional amendment or a changeover in the Supreme Court that overturned Citizens United on First Amendment grounds is that the Supreme Court has given corporations Fourth, Fifth, and 14th Amendment constitutional rights as well that they use to overturn our reasonable regulation. The only way to fix this problem permanently and completely is to amend the U.S. Constitution so that it says two things clearly and unequivocally. First, inalienable constitutional rights belong to natural human beings only, and secondly, that money is not speech. There is currently before Congress a proposed constitutional amendment that says just that. It's House Joint Resolution 48. It's called the We the People Amendment. It has been co-sponsored by 13 Democrats and one Republican. Neither you, Congressman Sarbanes, or you, Congresswoman DeGette, have endorsed, co-sponsored the We the People Amendment. If you truly believe that corporations are not people and money is not speech, why have you not co-sponsored the one constitutional amendment before Congress that says those two things?
Okay, great. So we're going to do all the questions and have to respond to all of them so we can have our next speaker come up and ask their question as well. And I do apologize, but we are over time, like I said, so we're trying to keep our panelists here so we can get through everyone. So thank you all for your indulgence.
Good morning. My name's Ethan. I live over in Congress Park. And I have just a rundown that was handed out of the Government by the People Act in one hand and the Fair Elections Now Act, which is co-sponsored by Bernie Sanders. And I want to point out that there are striking similarities between these two pieces of legislation. I mean, they are, even and not just in terms of the actual concepts, but some of the numbers are even the same.
I can answer this quickly. They're companion bills.
Right, so and
that's the Senate option of that.
That's what I wanted to hear. My thunder was stolen. I wanted to ask about the constitutional amendment. Dianna, I've talked to you about it before, and I know where you're coming from on that. Senator Sanders does support a constitutional amendment.
I'll talk about that.
That'd be great. Thanks for coming. Thank you, everybody else, for coming, too.
Yes, thank you. Next question.
Hi, guys. Thanks for this opportunity. So I would like a YouTube video of your advice on how to do this campaign finance, public financing scheme. That would be very helpful, especially for people not in the room. And also, please endorse Bernie Sanders because I think you know the argument. And also, no TPP if you guys care about the environment. It's diabolical, okay? It's and also for the banks, outlaw usury, outlaw interest loans, interest on any kinds of loans. It's in all Abrahamic religions. It's so Torah, Bible, Quran. No interest. It's a sin.
Okay,
get on the mic then.
Give
a question.
Next question. So, this HR20 sounds great. Have you, are there provisions to index it for inflation so it continues to be relevant?
Good question.
Yes, there, I answered that question.
Hi, my name's Carol Peoples. Welcome to Colorado, first. Congresswoman DeGette, you represent me, and I have also wanted to know why you have not signed on any of the legislation around that following through on Amendment 65's request for you to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Our last question.
I would like to say that I think that money in big money in campaign in politics is one of the most important issues that we have to address, and second only to global climate change and the future of our world and of our children and grandchildren. And so I have to say that you, there is no time for a status quo candidate such as Hillary Clinton. We have to have somebody who is really going to make a difference. That is Bernie Sanders, and I'd like to hear you speak to that, because I totally celebrate your loyalty to Hillary Clinton, but when you look at who can make a difference and who will be the status quo, I'm afraid that there really isn't any choice but Bernie.
I think both these questions were directed towards me, appropriately, since I'm your congresswoman. So before I answer them, can we just give a big hand to this panel? Elena, Kim, and Kirsten work tirelessly every day to make sure that the voices of Coloradoans are heard, and that what you guys do are so important, so thank you. And I also want to give another big round of applause to a man who has faith in the 5%. So thank you for that. Let me just quickly say, I know we have a lot of Bernie supporters here, and as I said, I have a lot of respect for Bernie. I served with him in the House for many, many years. I actually happen to think on climate change and issues like that, Hillary feels the same way, and it's just my perspective. Look, we can disagree. That's why we're Americans. But from my perspective, I believe that as a senior member of the Energy and Commerce Committee and two senior members, that we can work with her to get it passed. And I will also say that when we passed the climate change bill through the House, the first time, we passed it by two votes. As chief deputy whip for the Democrats, I was the person who was tasked with getting that bill out of committee and then passing it through the floor, which is the hardest job I ever did, because we had a bunch of Democrats who wouldn't vote for that bill. But we were able to get 13 Republicans to help us. We passed it by two votes, and then, of course, the Senate didn't take it up. So my number one priority when Hillary or Bernie becomes president, whichever one, is to sit down with them and to sit down with Democrats and Republicans and say to them, this is the looming issue of our lifetime. This is this little girl's future at stake. What are we going to do to pass this through Congress? That's my commitment to you, and I think we can make that happen. Now, on this issue, a number of people asked, I'll just group this question together. A number of people have asked my opinion on co-sponsoring the constitutional amendment to amend the Constitution to remove this Supreme Court definition under Citizens United. First of all, let me say, many of you know this, but I'm a lawyer by training. And for most of my career, I did a lot of constitutional work. I am not opposed to amending the Constitution to make sure that corporations are not defined as people. I think that has got to be the most ridiculous and extreme interpretation that the Supreme Court has ever made of the First Amendment when they said that corporations were people. So let's just stipulate to that. As a constitutional lawyer, I've always been hesitant about opening up the First Amendment where we think we could take this very, very targeted shot at removing that, but I always worry if you open up the First Amendment, what other mischief could be done. And so that's been my only hesitation. It's not really an opposition, it's just a hesitation. And that's and the second thing is, I think if we put all of our energy into amending the Constitution, then we may lose the ability to fix the problem sooner. Because as I said in my opening remarks, we have an opportunity to get a new Supreme Court justice who will revisit Citizens United, and in the next term or two of Congress, who will overturn this. So that's, like I say, I'm not opposed to amending the Constitution, but I'm very skittish about opening the First Amendment for things that unintended consequences. And the last thing I will say is that there's the constitutional amendment. I think that if we both go at the Citizens United opinion and some of the other Supreme Court opinions to get those reversed, and we pass the Sarbanes bill, which is the Sanders bill in the Senate, and we pass this other legislation, it's going to go a long way at opening up the sunlight to this process and empowering the voters. I'm encouraged, actually, by voters beginning to demand more access to the system and more participation in the system. But it's the job of the voters, too. And sometimes I will meet people who say to me, well, you know, I don't vote. It just encourages them. And I say, you know what, then? You're not allowed to complain. And so what I would say, and what I would really appreciate as your congressperson, is that if we all get a groundswell of support, not just for people like us who already agree with you on this, but to go talk to the Republicans in our delegation, to go talk to make a groundswell across the country of citizens in every congressional district, not just the first congressional district of Colorado, but every place. Because at that point, and the other thing I'll say is elections matter. And so who goes to the polls in November is going to determine how this happens. So thank you all for coming. Thanks to everybody. You want to just thank you to
I just wanted to say, keep your eye on two prizes. There's the presidency, and we get really caught up in the presidential sweepstakes. But there's the Congress. Yeah. The fact of the matter is that whatever Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders want to do, it's simply a matter of degree, and it's a fairly modest degree against what the Republicans would do. And the other thing is, they could become president, and they may want to fix the hedge fund loophole, and they may want to get rid of oil and gas subsidies and so forth and so on. But if Congress can't pass that,
right,
they can't do it. They cannot do that by executive order. They cannot do it by fiat. It is the Congress of the United States that passes these laws. And so if we don't liberate Congress from the undue influence that big money has, or the kinds of creative solutions that we're talking about here today, Gandhi could become president. It would make a difference. So we have to keep our eye on both prizes, presidency and the Congress.
Thank you.